Everyone, can I have your attention, please? So first of all, apologies, we are starting a little bit late. And my name is Rachael Kiang. I'm the manager and curator of Gallery Lane Cove, and also the curator of this show. Now I want to first begin by acknowledging the Cammeraygal people and the land on which we operate, and we pay respects to all First Nations people. Just a very quick introduction of our speakers today and the format. So we have, of course, in the centre, our star, Guy Warren himself, the artist. We have two guys left.
Two guys left.
Katrina Cashman, Assistant Director of Mosman Art Gallery. And then we have to the right of Guy, Rhonda Davis, Senior Curator of Macquarie University Gallery. And I'm afraid there's apologies from Karen Cass, from the manager of Wollongong Art Collection, where Guy also has a current exhibition because she's just got a medical issue, so apologies from her. And in terms of today's format, it is a panel, so there will be obviously questions and conversations between each of the panelists. We will of course first focus on this show, but then we'll also talk about the other shows that are on at the moment for Guy. So in case, you know, for those of you who don't know, most of you do, Guy has another show on at the National Art School, which is focused on drawing. And then he has this show here with us, mostly focused on painting. And at the University of Wollongong, he has a show that focuses on his relationship with Wollongong and while he was director of the art collection. Okay. So we shall begin, and thank you everyone for your understanding and putting on the masks. We just have to abide by New South Wales health regulations. In fact, the day they had the regulations, the next morning I had an email from them saying, make sure your gallery doesn't wear a mask. So thank you. Okay, so we shall actually have a little bit of a look back and start with Katrina. Because Katrina was Katrina Cashman, Assistant Director of the Mosman Art Gallery, was probably the first person who was put together a very comprehensive retrospective on Guy's show at Mosman Art Gallery in early 2000s. So looking back at your experience with that, can you sort of comment on, you know, that show and then crossing over to this current one?
Well, I mean, the thing about the exhibition at Mosman was, and I'm speaking without the mic, so I'll just try and talk as loudly as I can. Can you hear me at the back?
Yeah.
Yeah, great, okay. So the thing about the exhibition at Mosman was, I think we felt that it was just this incredible opportunity to work with an artist that had really not had the profile at the biggest state institutions that we felt he really deserved. In fact, the director at the time was Tony Geddes. It was his suggestion that we curate the exhibition. And of course, with Guy being kind of down the road, we like to say, I lived in Lane Cove, and he was in Greenwich, and Mosman was, you know, my destination each day. So it was actually a really, really great kind of locality for the two of us to get together. And then, of course, over at the studio at Leichhardt. But, you know, we wanted to claim him, really. That's what we wanted to do. And that's because this institution wasn't here. So we took that opportunity. But we also felt that it was really, you know, an oversight that such a major retrospective hadn't been staged in Sydney. And it was just an absolute pleasure and an honour to work with Guy. I think we had about 2 years in the making leading up, and the process was really wonderful. I think at first, Guy, you were probably a little bit not sure. I was young and eager and probably just wanted to open every plan drawer as quickly as I could and go through the racks as quickly as I could. But what we did was actually a really great suggestion, which was Guy's idea, which was we turned the studio into a gallery, and we slowly went through every rack. We slowly pulled things out. We got an install team in, we got the rails up, the wires, and we could put everything up and just spend time with the work. And that was just a brilliant suggestion. And I found that after a while he didn't want to take the paintings down. He was actually quite enjoying being surrounded by these, you know, this was, I think we covered 5 decades, didn't we, Guy? 5 decades of painting.
I can't remember.
He was quite enjoying seeing the chronology and seeing the stages of work. And so, of course, we had those very early watercolours from his time as a war artist. And I think we've got 2 pieces on the first panel here. There's just very exquisite watercolours of New Guinea, and particularly referencing the soldiers. And then, of course, you know, Guy is just, you know, drawing is like living and breathing for Guy, of course, like it is for most artists. And of course, his sketchbooks and notebooks were just filled with so many incredible images of local people and of other Australian soldiers. But I think we can, you know, say with absolute confidence that we know that that time spent at Bougainville was just the formative part of his development as an artist. And those images of the local people, the Papua New Guineans, some, you know, in everyday clothing, but some dressed in, you know, kind of cultural attire, so to speak, for a men's ceremony. They were just indelibly marked in his consciousness, and I think just became an ingrained part of his psyche, and we saw that development. We saw Guy's work traverse a range of places, but those images were always so central. So I think, you know, we do have a couple of those very important Bougainvillean, but these are probably, I mean, I love so many aspects of Guy's work, but I'll always return to those Bougainville canvases, Guy. In the back corner, we've got, I can't remember their titles.
Warrior and Princess.
And we've got the green one.
Green Warrior.
We've got Red Warrior.
Red Warrior and Princess. Yeah, they're just so important. And every mark that's in those works, you can see the development of his idiom and the development of his visual language that as it traces through the path of his trajectory. So that time, I suppose, Guy, you would always refer to that time as being so seminal in your development, and then again that, you know, connection back to the Australian bush. I know when you went on your honeymoon with Joy, you went up to Queensland and went camping. Who wants to be taken camping on their honeymoon? the young couple deeply in love had a wonderful time going camping right in the Australian rainforest up in the Valley of the Albert in Queensland. And at Mosman, we've got a guy who won the Mosman Art Prize in 1950, and the painting that he won it with is this incredible landscape piece from, I like to say it's from the honeymoon, inspired by that trip on the honeymoon. And again, we've also got some wonderful watercolour sketches that Guy did with Joy on that trip, so it's very special to us. But I think, you know, that immersion in that part of Papua New Guinea, that very dense part of Papua New Guinea, the connection with people, you know, just immediately formed that notion that people and the landscape is enduring, the natural world is an enduring subject for many artists, but it's deeply rooted in our human connection, our mankind's connection with landscape. And of course, that's the whole thematic of this exhibition. And, you know, what's wonderful, Guy, is to see, I guess, the trajectory, but also to see the work that you created in lockdown last year, and all these new pieces, and again, those kind of iconic images that you produce in terms of your figurative approach, like your the winged man, your rainforest goddess, man in a boat, all of these pieces that you return to but done in such a beautifully fresh and vigorous way. And that's what's exciting for me, is to see the vigour of your work right now.
Mm. Guy, so, would you like to talk about, thank you, Katrina, I'm just going to bring this back to
the
start. Can you tell the audience here a little bit more about the work that you did in 2020? Because there's quite a whole wall of them here, starting from this end all the way. It's remarkably prolific and amazing. There is also quite a sort of strong focus on the figure, still in the landscape, but definitely less abstract. Do you want to talk a bit about that period of painting last year?
Well, but mostly it was during that period of lockdown, and that sort of lasted for a long time. What else have you got to do? You know, you've got to keep on making marks. It was the best time I've had for a long time. Nobody came to see me. It was great. I did a lot of work, and I didn't know, largely because I couldn't go out, or didn't. Yeah, well, I couldn't go out. You couldn't go out and mix with people. So I didn't go out and draw anywhere. I started looking through old sketchbooks, and I have hundreds of sketchbooks at home that go back, would you believe, to the 1930s, my God. And I found a sketchbook that I'd used many years ago now, when I went to the Bungles, if anybody knows where the Bungles are, in the Northern Territory. And I found a lot of drawings there that I hadn't seen for a while, hadn't looked at for a while. And I thought, maybe there's something here that I can carry on with. So that's how those things occur. The shapes are the shapes of the bungles, which are, for those people who don't know, they're a very strange, what's the word?
Formations,
thank you, yes. Rock formations. Can everybody hear me at the back?
Yes. Yes.
I apologize for my voice, which has suddenly gone very hoarse. Yes, they're rock formations, which are really quite extraordinary. And they sometimes group together, they're sometimes individual. They sometimes appear to have eyes in them. They have holes, small caves, or small indentations, which collect the shadow and the light. So they end up looking like faces. And I've always liked the idea of having figures in the landscape. This is a long story. I don't want to. Oh, God. After a while, you find yourself telling the same story and saying the same things so many, many times that you think it becomes boring after a while. So, if anybody's heard anything before, please forgive me.
None of us are bored, Guy. We're all bored.
We don't know anything about you. Right.
You have fresh new audiences here.
Fresh new artists.
let's get back to the beginning. I spent some time on the island of Bougainville during the war. Drew a lot of the local peoples, was fascinated by how they looked and why their faces were different from my face and other people's face. I was fascinated by the country itself, which is fantastic. Mountains and volcanoes and rainforest, the lot. Great, great country, visually enormously exciting. So I did a lot of drawing there, and some watercolours. After the war, after I was discharged, I did 3 years at the National Art School, where the other drawing show was on at the moment. And then John and I got married and we went to London. Now London, this was 1950s. I won the Mosman Art Prize, which was 50 guineas.
Not much money.
Not a lot of money, no. Anyway, we went to London, and London in the 50s was fantastic because it was the end of the war. Everybody was beginning to find their future again. The galleries were all open again. The Brits were showing from every corner of Britain. lost time, the beginning of abstract expressionism started, and from 3 years at the National Art School in Sydney, which was a good traditional school, but it was a traditional school, the sort of thing that came from Leonardo. One drew as one was expected to draw, and one painted. One was taught how to paint, and what to do, and how to put the paint down. But there was no excitement, there was no question of curiosity or invention, or there were no questions asked. So finding yourself in London, where everybody was asking questions in the 50s, was like, well, chalk and cheese. It was just incredibly, incredibly exciting. So I thought I'd start painting London and the English landscape, and I found that didn't work at all. I had to find a job, of course. I mean, you can't get over there and sit in your backside and paint. Joy got a job, and I walked around the corner one day and found a frame-making establishment. And so I thought I'd go in and ask for a job. I've never made a frame in my life. But I asked for a job, and he said, you can start tomorrow. And so the next day I went back. I wasn't making frames, I was working in the cellar, I don't know, doing things with frames, I think. But there were several other young guys in there as well. It turned out they were all all young painters or students. One of them stepped forward as I walked down the room room, waiting at the foot of the stairs into the cellar. And one of them stepped forward and with an Australian accent said, we heard there was another Australian named Warren starting today. And I wondered, I thought it might be that bastard Alan Warren. Now, I didn't know who Alan Warren was. I found out subsequently that the fellow who made that remark was Fred Williams. And Alan Warren, I found, had been an art critic and an art teacher in Melbourne. So what he'd ever said or written about Fred, I don't know. But whatever it was, Fred hadn't liked it. So I started painting London, and I wasn't in London, but it had all been done, and wasn't me. And I went into the landscape, and the British landscape was gorgeous and beautiful, but it's like a huge park. It's not, there's no rainforest there. It wasn't nice or country. So in desperation, I started painting those jungle paintings down in the far left-hand corner. And I mean, in London, here's this dill painting New Guinea in London. And let's face it, it's a pretty strange thing to do. But I was working from memory and from a few sketches and a few photographs. And one night we had a little black and white television set, and we saw a documentary of some bloke who'd been to New Guinea and done a documentary of the dancers at Mount Hagen and the Harbors of New Guinea. There's a big dance festival there, and the dancers wear most incredibly inventive costumes. Feathers, flowers, masks, you name it. Both in their clothes and their decoration, was just incredibly inventive. And I found this in Bougainville as well. If you gave something to any of the locals, they'd immediately put it on their face. It seemed almost as though they were decorating themselves in a very decorative environment. So in a funny sort of way, it seemed to me to make a point about statement about belonging to the land. So that's how it all started. So I started painting these idiot paintings of people dressed up and merging into the bush. And so I saw this documentary and I thought, my God, that's exactly the sort of memory I would like to have. I'd like to have some of those photographs. So I wrote to the BBC and said, could I buy some of the photographs you had? And I imagine I sent something like on this young Australian in London painting New Guinea. And I don't know what happened. Somebody probably got the letter and thought, what a deal. And passed it around to somebody else. They might have passed it around to half a dozen people wondering what the hell I had to answer. And then I got a ring one day from some bloke who said he was interested in the letter and he wouldn't give me any photographs, but he could certainly lend me some. And he introduced himself over the phone. He said his name was David Attenborough and I'd like to come around for a drink. So I went and joined round for a drink and met David. The stupid little things you remember that are totally insignificant. He asked me what I'd like for a drink, and I asked what we'd like to drink, and Joy said she'd have a gin and tonic, and I said I'll have a whiskey. So he poured Joy a gin and tonic, and he poured me a fairly small whiskey, and he said, what would you like with it? Meaning soda, I guess, or water? And I said, well, actually, I prefer it neat. And he said, oh, well, you better have more than that then. I don't know why that's important. Every night now when I pour myself a whiskey, I think of that. It's always, you remember these idiot, unnecessary things. Anyway, David lent me a whole stack of photographs. And I worked from them and from memory to paint those paintings down there and a lot more. Had a show in London, and before I had the show, invited him and his wife around to our flat and offered him a painting, gave him his photographs back and offered him a painting in return for his help, which I'm delighted to say he still has. In fact, I had a letter from him the other day. I had my letter from the Queen, if anybody wanted. Stop worrying about it. She remembered.
And how did she say she was?
But more importantly, I think I got a letter from David. So, where the hell was I?
The whiskey.
I wanted to make sure you told that story about David Attenborough.
Yeah.
I wanted to make sure that you mentioned
that. I can't miss that one.
Yeah. It's actually really important because they both have a shared concern in different ways for man and the environment, or man and the environment, which is also talked about in my essay for this exhibition's catalogue.
Yeah. Well, starting from Bougainville and I suppose David and his photographs. And then subsequently, on return to Australia, learning more and more about our own indigenous people's attitude towards the landscape, and realizing the significance of how they feel about their relationship to the land, where the land is not separate from them, but they are part of the land and the land is part of them, if I'm saying it in a simple and probably incorrect way. But it's this relationship to the land that I find fascinating, and it's because of that that I have subsequently frequently tried to make the figures that I put in the landscape, looking as though they are not so much as figures in the landscape, not figures put there to give scale to the landscape, but figures which are embedded in the landscape and embedded in the paint, if that makes sense. So they are part of the essential part of the painting. But one of the critics in a recent show I had complained that the figures looked as though they weren't, they had no feet and they weren't resting on the land. They're not meant to be resting on the bloody land, they are in the land. They are part of the painting, part of the land. I think maybe my thought is that sometimes they're too, what's the word?
Subtle?
Not too subtle, yes, exactly. I think they're not.
I think, Guy, you developed a technique with your layering and stenciling, and that whole technique is about that embedding an image, isn't it? And so essentially the figures are very abstract, the landscapes are very abstract. You're not rendering a figurative piece, it's essentially an abstract
form.
Can I just say something on this too? I feel when I look at these paintings here, the bungles, I feel like a sense of encapsulation within that landscape myself. I can see they're encased. The figures are sort of, as Guy says, they're embedded. And I don't have to visit the bungles. I'm there with that landscape when I look at this suite of works. They're the most incredible essays in space, history, memory, culture. And I think Guy has captured those, that sense of being within the landscape and part of that landscape, but I don't have to go there. Now, that is an incredible feat. And I also sense a comfort. These figures are encased, they're shrouded, they're sort of vibrating within the earth itself. So that sense of belonging is really, I think, what Guy has achieved in this suite.
Can I say something? I think there is a big difference between these paintings, which are late, very recent, and those older paintings down the far end there.
Yeah.
And I should explain that one of the problems I have is that I'm getting older and I can't do all the things that I used to be able to do. Those large paintings down the end there, particularly those at the direct end of this gallery now, were all done on the floor. They're not done only with brushes, they're done with chucked paper, anything I could put the paint on with, and working on the floor with acrylic paint, which was a creamy consistency. It means that you can move the paint around on the canvas, on the floor. So it's like kids with mud puddles. it's fun and you're in it, you're doing it. Well, sadly, I can't do that any longer. I can't kneel down, I can't work down like that. My bloody knees collapse. So that's why these things were done on an easel in front of me. And that's why they are different from those down there. No longer could I use paint that was creamy consistency, because once it's vertical, of course, if it's too soft, it'll run off. So that's why they look so different. Anyway, it's just another problem. One finds a way of overcoming the problem and working within the constraints of what is possible at any one time. The important thing is to keep on working, making marks. That's what it's about.
ask you then, Guy, the difference between painting on the floor and the easel, did that leap, it's sort of like a conceptual leap, did that inform the way the figures are placed?
The way the figures are placed, yes, I suppose it does, it must inevitably, because sometimes the figures appear on those down there because of the accident of doing it. And here they are more considered. Yes. That's fair enough.
But Guy, even beyond the practical aspects of, you know, the physicality of working kneeling down, what is remarkable is throughout your career you've really experimented with different ways of painting, different techniques, and yet, you know, the central motifs come through throughout the decades. So a few people have remarked to gallery staff as they come through, that's amazing, it's so different, some of your works, especially in the early days. For example, these ones on the left, and also the figure where the work on the right where it's a double figure as well as the folded canvas.
Okay, I'll explain about that. I've always done a lot of watercolours, and one of the ways I prefer to work with watercolour, and I do it most of the time, is to work on wet paper. So I wet the paper first. So with most watercolours, I'm working on wet paper. Now it's pretty obvious that if you work with the wet paint on wet paper, the paint will spread, and I like the idea of the paint spreading, and I can do things with it when it spreads like that. And at one stage, I don't know when it was, I realised that, of course, I thought, well, why the hell if I can do it on paper with a water-based paint, like watercolour, why can't I do it on canvas with a water-based paint? So I started, in fact, those two paintings, the red one and the green one, over there were done like that. The paint, the canvas was very wet. The acrylic is water-based, so if you put the acrylic paint on the canvas, obviously it spreads exactly like watercolour does on wet paper. And then some of them I did where the image was very soft, and some of them I did with a soft image and hard images as well, which is what those two are. And that inevitably, of course, there's a clear relationship between me and that. At that time, between what I was doing on paper and what I was doing on canvas. And one of the things I was doing on paper was asking myself, why does the paper have to be flat all the time? You know, you can do things with paper. So I started poking holes in the paper. I started folding the paper, and I went down to Hobart and worked with the art school down there, and there was a guy down there who was making paper. He had a paper mill down there at the school, so I was actually making paper. And when you make paper, it's like clay, it's soft and malleable, and you can fold it, you can tear it, you can do all sorts of extraordinary things with it. So I came back again and thought, well, why can't I do that with canvas? So that's how things like this thing on the right here happened. I started folding the canvas, and then I had a show at a big gallery in Sydney.
Thank you.
Kim's gallery had a 50 foot long wall. So, I mean, this is a dumb thing to do. You get ideas, and sometimes they're dumb, and sometimes you think, well, what's the matter? Let's push it along and see what happens. Curiosity is the most important thing. We're all curious. You've got to look around the corner. You've got to wonder what's around the corner. What would happen if I did this? Because it's not only you that's making decisions. It's the canvas and the paper and the paint, and they all talk to you. They make decisions too. Anyway, this over Christmas one year, I decided to get a 15-meter roll of canvas, and I was working at Sydney University, and I had an old shed there.
Mark School, old guy.
Sorry,
the Mark School.
I think the microphone battery's run.
Here we go.
Thanks.
I'll yell louder.
No, give him another mic.
The man
microphone. So I had a 50-yard roll of canvas, and I had it on a roller at that side of the studio, and I rolled it down across a table and painted something on it every day over a whole Christmas period, and then when I painted something on it, when it was that much and finished, I rolled it up onto another roller on that side. So it was I did something every day and then rolled it up to one long roll of canvas. How's that?
Better.
Right. So it was a bit like a diary, I guess. There was something on it every day, starting at one end and finishing at the other. So I decided to show it to Kim and Arthur's gallery. Kim was one of the few dealers who would allow you to. There were no restrictions. He let you show what you wanted to show. So I unrolled this canvas and hung it on the 50-meter wall. I had trouble hanging it up, but a young student teaching at the architecture school at the university at the time, and a young student named Immens Tillis came and helped me hang it up, and he made a little frame that it hung from. But the wall was 50 yards long, and my canvas was 50 meters long. So it didn't quite fit. So then I thought, well, why can't it be folded? So I folded the bit to take up the slack. And that's where things like this one came from. I mean, that, I thought, well, it doesn't have to be on the wall. Why can't it be on the stretcher? And I can actually fold the canvas. I can stain the canvas, because that's what you can do with acrylic. Do I have to have two? Wow.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
I love the relationship between those, the double figures, where you've wrapped the I think it's a female model in the wet canvas, presumably, and then spray painted, and you get that incredible figurative form. But what's lovely about it is the mountain shapes. It's like two. It's like, you know, we talked about figures being encased in a mountain in the recent work, but if we look at those works and compare it with the double figures, you've actually got the sense of the figure making the mountain. Making that mountain form. It's a really beautiful relationship.
Thank you.
But my question is, sorry, just moving on quickly, with these folded works, that obviously at the time that you were making them, it was a thing in the art world, or lots of
way, looking for three-dimensional form. I'm thinking of people like Joan Brassel or even Michael Johnson with pushing out these big three-dimensional box canvases, people with stretching canvas and trying to manipulate it. How conscious were you of the time of what else was happening in that art scene at the time in Sydney?
I don't think I was that conscious of it. In fact, I didn't know that Michael Johnson had done anything like that. So that's
right. Yes. He used wood as an armature and formed blocks, and then he did kind of combinations of blocks, so each block is covered in a... they were very different from your work because they're hard-edge abstraction and really, really bright colour, but he was using canvas in stretched across different forms to try and make different planes. It was in his the National Gallery of Victoria show, the field. Oh, Rhonda, you know all about the field.
Oh, the field,
those were times when people were investigating and being curious and trying different things. And of course, we were all impressed, I suppose, by what was happening overseas. I think I was less aware of what other people were doing, but just being stupid and playing around and trying things.
I think all of us would agree that none of it's stupid, none of it's playing around, that all of it's about your willingness to accept risk and the challenge of the new and moving.
Look,
always moving.
Yeah, let me give credit here to Bert Fugelman. I don't know how many of you remember Bert. He was a student with me after the war. I worked with him at Sydney University, and Bert was a risk taker. He was curious, he did strange things. Some of them brilliant, some of them dumb, but the point of it is that he tried them. And I think I learned a lot from Bert's attitude. He was always happy to try something new. He had an idea and he'd follow the idea. So I think that I probably learned a lot from Bert in that sort of way. It is about being curious, it's about being, well, what would happen if I did this? Would it work or wouldn't it work? And what does work mean? What do I mean when I say will it work? Will there be something there that is interesting, or can I push the idea a bit further? So I'd like to give credit to Bert there. I think he helped me to release me a bit, perhaps.
Well, I think you both helped each other enormously, didn't you? You had that great relationship, great friendship, and of course you built your studios in the bush next to each other. So it was an ongoing kind of supportive connection.
Oh, you haven't heard the last of that.
Right, yeah, tell us.
have you seen any?
I have.
Yeah. Well, for those who haven't heard, since Joy died and since I got a bit older, I haven't been down to the shack very often, I'm afraid. But so it's become a little derelict and unfriendly, and it's like if you leave a space for a while, it somehow ceases to be friendly. And so I haven't been down very much. And some dear, dear, dear friends of mine apparently got together without telling me anything about it recently and wondered what they would like to do for my 100th birthday. And without my knowledge, my son and Anne Cape and...
Is he at the back?
He was here at the back. And Carolyn, who bought Bert's place, so together the silent for my 100th birthday, they would give the shack a bit of new life. So they all went down there, cleaned it up, polished it, invited me down last Sunday. I thought just for lunch at Carolyn's place next door. I went down there. The shack looks as though it's just been built. It is shiny, new, friendly. There's a fire on in the shack. There was a fire outside. The glass is clean. The curtains have been cleaned. All the anti-climate shit has been moved out. It's just unbelievable what they did. So I now have a little shack down there that I'll be delighted to go to every day. Isn't it? Yes. How extraordinary it is to have friends like that.
Can I ask a question,
yes.
Guy? I'm just wondering how important drawing is to your practice.
Yes, that's great.
Yeah, it's very important. Now let's be clear about this. I think what is important, and this is common to all these things, making a mark is important to me. I think making a mark is a primal urge for mankind, humankind. Since some idiot picked up a burnt stick from a fire and made a mark on a cave wall, people have been making marks. Now, at one and the same time, the mark he or she made at that time was the most abstract of things and the most human of things. Abstract because it didn't mean a damn thing. Human because it said, I am human, I am here. So making a mark is something that people have always done. They do it now. Graffiti artists make marks on my studio at Leichhardt, all over the bloody wall. It is an essential thing. People want to make a mark. And painting is the same, except that painting then carries the mark further, and you have the possibility of making it look real or not real. You have the possibility of creating apparent space. You have the ability to think about texture and color. So it's still making a mark. That's what these are about. They're making marks. Now, why do we do it? Because it's an essential thing. There are other primal urges, obviously. Dance must be one of them. Music must be one. Perhaps telling stories is one. There are other primal urges. But enough is enough. Making marks is enough for me. I keep on making marks.
Can I also say on that note, I have this sense there's singing and dancing embedded within this particular series, and at the back there, I sense this rhythmic movement of dance and sort of movement not only within space and time, history and memory, but movement within your surrounding space.
Well, that's an interesting way of looking at it. Yeah, I'm happy to go along with that. But that's one of the great joys of art, you know, people read it in different ways.
Guy, I do have a question too. The painting right at the back, the centre panel, was actually one that I chose that hasn't been shown other than that one on the gallery.
Yeah.
That really stood out for me, and of course it ties very nicely to Cave on the left and Odyssey on the right.
The one in the middle you're talking about.
Yes, what's the story behind, would you like to share with everyone the story behind the work?
No.
No, it's a bit too personal.
Much too personal.
Okay. Sorry. other than the fact that you created that in Paris.
I did indeed, yes. It was in Paris, and I had one of the studios in Paris, I think the one that belonged to the Australia Council. And Joy and I were there for 3 months, I think. And at that stage, I'd been doing these other ones, like the ones left and right of it, which were done on the floor with a lot of paint and very messy. And I couldn't do that in another studio that I didn't know. So I had to find a way of doing it. It's done on paper, obviously with a large amount of paper, put it on the floor somehow, and worked. I got acrylic paint, I remember, and worked with chunks and other bits of paper, actually dipping the bits of paper and the bits of cloth in the paint, and then putting it on the paper. So I was painting with, putting the paint on with paper and cloth, and then drawing on it subsequently with a brush. And it worked quite well. And when I came, I must have rolled the paper up when I came back to Sydney. I got somebody to mount it onto canvas. Otherwise it would have been torn and lost, and I was rather fond of it anyway.
So I've got a question for both Rhonda and Katrina. Have you both seen or read about the National Art School, Guy's National Art School?
Yes, the National Art School, yes.
Yes. Could I ask both of you to comment on, you know, in terms of Guy's practice, the two different shows, and then we can talk briefly also about
Sure. Well, I think, you know, what's extraordinary about the best part about it, I think, is it's wonderful that the art school have actually honoured Guy with the first exhibition in their new drawing gallery. Absolutely worth seeing. I think it's on for one more week if you can get over there. But what I was really excited about was seeing again Guy's major large scale drawings in with those emblematic images of the wingman. And the mountain, and the calligraphic nature of the black ink just really directly drawn with some blue. And Guy, maybe you'd like just to talk a little bit about, I mean, it's a very special drawing show. It's got a range of works through Guy's you know, practice and career. But I think that Icarus is an essential emblematic figure that we haven't really touched on. It'd be great to discuss that, and perhaps the biggest drawing you've ever done. I'd like to talk about that.
Well, that's easy.
Why an Icarus? How did it come about?
Well, it came about because I'd been offered the opportunity to go down and work at Arthur Boyd's studio on the Shoalhaven. Arthur Boyd was in London, and the studio was empty. And I think there was another agenda that I didn't know about. I think the school, Sydney College, that I was working at the time, I think they might have had the idea of trying to perhaps use Arthur's property as a sort of country campus. And this was long before he'd given it to the nation, so it was empty, not being used. And I was asked if I'd like to go down there and work down there for a while. I'd just come back from New York, and I had 3 months left of my sabbatical, so I went down there and lived in Arthur's beautiful big stone house near the river on my own. It was a bit weird at night, surrounded by Arthur's paintings. The studio was separate from the house, a very small studio, lined with wood and with a skylight above. And once you were in it, you were totally enclosed. There was no light, no window out to the outside world. But a big black bird used to come down and batter itself against the skylight. And I don't know why I found that odd, but I did. I mean, I was captured inside and it was free. So it was this a bit weird that it was trying to get in. Anyway, it was probably, I don't know. Anyway, I started drawing this bird battering itself against the glass of the skylight. Then when I went, finished there, I went back to my shed at Jamboree, and I found that hang gliders were leaping off the cliffs above me, flying over the shack and down into the valley. Nothing like confidence, dangerous. They could have landed in the rainforest and landed on top of this giant sting tree or something. Anyway, the council stopped on doing it after a while. I started drawing flying figures. They became birds. They became every culture in the world has flying figures in it. We have angels. We have all sorts of images like that. So it became birds. It became angels. It became butterflies. It became just a flying figure. And then inevitably, of course, I thought of the other flying figure, which is the story of Icarus. And if you know the Greek myth of Icarus, who escaping from King Minos, I think it was, with his father, Daedalus, his father, who was a great inventor, said we can escape from here if we make our own wings and fly away. And he made wings out of sealing wax and feathers, and he attached them to himself and to his son. And his son was a young man, and his dad said to his son, don't fly too close to the sun because the sun will melt the wax, and don't fly too close to the water because the water will make the wings heavy. So it was they flew away, and of course the sun did all the wrong things and fell into the sea and drowned. That's still called the Icarian Sea even today. But it's about escape. It's about listening to what your father says.
It's about risk, isn't it?
It's about risk-taking. It's about risk-taking. It's about journeying. It's about escape. It's about all those things. And particularly, it's about risk-taking. And I thought this, in a way, applied to Bert Flugman, because Bertie was a risk taker and he fell on his face many times. He'd always pick himself up and start again. And that's when, having dinner one night with Bert and friends of his somewhere down there in Wollongong, at a dinner table, some woman whom I didn't know met across the table and said, have you two guys ever gone in for the Archibald? And we made the usual responses like, nah, you know, it's a chill raffle, nobody goes in for that, and we don't take it seriously. And then Bert perhaps had a couple of glasses of wine more than I had, because he went across the table and said, I'll challenge you. You paint me and I'll paint you and you're going. So I said, right, I paint, you know, okay. And I forgot all about it for a week, and he rang me up and said, when do we start? So I was stuck with it then. So he painted me and I painted him, and I reached the point where I had a good painting. It was a very good likeness, and it was fresh and I liked what I'd done, and I thought, I need something else which says something about Bert's character. So I thought of the Icarus image, and I thought, maybe if I paint Icarus's wings behind him, because I've been using the wings for a while by then in drawings, and maybe that might say something about his character. Now, this is where it became weird, very weird, because as I drew the things in, I suddenly realised for the first time that Bert's name, Flügelmann, is German for wingman. Now that was weird. That made the hair stand at the back of the stand up on the back of the neck. I hadn't known that before. I hadn't thought of it. I don't speak German. Suddenly registered that Bert's name was wingman. So, and I put it in the Archibald. And that year, for the first time, the trustees made what was clearly the most intelligent.
Well, I'm yet to see the drawing show, Rachael, and I will go and see that. But what I am interested in with Guy's work is the fact that he went to the National Arts School, and it's a place to support artillery practice. It's a place, it's always had that tradition and history of drawing as integral to painting. And I think that really comes clear when you look at this exhibition, because this exhibition is also about drawing, in a sense, because the hidden lines, the lines here with paint are actually drawing to me, in a sense. The also drawing is... It has a rawness to it. As Guy was saying, paper as a medium is quite different. It can be light, but what Guy was also explaining is that you can actually manipulate paper to make it quite dense. And hence it has sort of this weight, and it has its own sense of a relationship between the viewer, the maker, and the paper, so that it's a lovely medium in a sense. And I always think of Joy Hester in particular, and with Guy, painting and drawing on the floor. Like, it's a practice that you can do anywhere, at any time, take your notebook with you and you can sketch. And I think that's what Guy did quite a lot. He can talk a little bit more about the sketchbooks. But also, the drawing really informs the painting, that painting process. If anyone's had the chance to draw, does anyone draw here? Yeah. Does anyone paint here? Yeah, okay, I've tried drawing and I've tried a little bit of painting, and oh my God, mixing paint is another realm, isn't it? It's really amazing, the skill you need. But I think with drawing you can learn how to draw and to then do abstraction, like a lot of people say, oh, you know, we've heard that saying, my four-year-old kid could do better. But to actually do abstraction, you need to draw realistically first up. I don't know. You might disagree.
Yeah, well, everybody has their own ideas of what drawing might be. In fact, that was the question that we were asked. The one in New South Wales.
Yeah.
Mm.
Cover,
thank you. Yep.
Thank you.
And he was going to put on an exhibition of drawing, and actually it all came about, apparently something I said was the key to the drawing. I didn't know that until later. But Kevin Connor had won the Nobel Prize, and I know Kevin very well, and the work he put in looked like a painting rather than a drawing. It was done with paint and had space in it. It wasn't a drawing, as I think of a drawing as a linear, mainly a linear thing. I don't know why, but I always do. And so I said to him, mate, that's not a bloody drawing, it's a painting. And he must have said this to Nick Waterlow, and Nick decided to put on an exhibition which questioned what was the difference between drawing and painting. So he asked a number of artists to ask themselves that question and to put their work in the show. So he contacted me and said, you know, try and do something different, you know, do something. In fact, I think Lou Klepek got involved at that stage, and Lou said, look, why don't you do something like, I don't know, get a lawnmower and do something on the grass? And I said, oh, I think that's been done, there's got to be some other way of doing this. And then I suddenly thought of the Icarus image, and I thought it would be fun to draw the Icarus image, but where is the best place to do the Icarus image? Well, clearly the best place would be in the sky. Where else would Icarus be? So I got the yellow pages out and phone book, look through it. I've rang dozens of people who did sky writing, and they passed me on to other people. Finally, I found some bloke in the Gold Coast who said he had his own plane, and he thought he could do something like that. So I sent him dozens of drawings of my Icarus figure, and he actually did a trial run in the Gold Coast and sent me photographs. And they were brilliant, they were absolutely right. So I said, okay, let's do it. So it was planned to be done on the opening of Nick's show. And, you know, we were all going to meet down at Mr. Macquarie's chair and watch the plane do this drawing in the sky. Well, he rang me that morning and said, you can't do it, it's going to be raining over Sydney today. And then the next day it was grey, and the next day it was grey, and this went on for about a week. And then one day, I was on the wind every morning, at 6 o'clock every morning, and one day he said, it's going to be fine over Sydney today, and it's going to be grey again for another week. So if you want to do it, it'll have to be today. So okay. I said, okay, let's do it. Let's try it. So we all gathered down at Mr. Macquarie's chair, and it was a brilliant day. It was absolutely gorgeous, sunny, beautiful Sydney day. And 12 o'clock, we were all there looking at the sky, and nothing happened. And at 12:15, a little white spot started up in the sky, just a white spot, no more. And suddenly that white spot became a figure, and suddenly that figure sprouted wings, and you couldn't see the plane. It was 14,000 feet and you couldn't see it. And if the figure just appeared, it was miraculous. It was astonishing, it really was. The pilot explained to me later, I hadn't known this, it's obvious, that if you draw something in the sky and then have to add to it, you've got to fly 300 feet above it or below it, because you can't fly at it and into it, because you disperse what's already there. That's pretty obvious, and all of it. And every time he added a wing, it was absolutely spot on. drawing show at the NASA show, there is a video which my son took, and it's worth looking at the video, and you'll see that the body is there, and the wing is attached exactly where it should be. That's brilliant flying. I've spoken to flyers about this. They say it's pretty good flying. And then I thought, the day that he did it, I thought, I've got to get some publicity on this. I'm not very good at publicity, but I must be able to get some somehow. So I rang every newspaper and I rang every television station, and I probably said something like, I'm a Sydney artist and I'm going to do a drawing over Sydney at about 14,000 feet using a Cessna. And I'm doing it at midday today, and you might be interested. And every time I spoke to somebody, they said the same thing. They said, yeah, but right home, mate, and put the phone down. God, you know, what's wrong with these guys? It wasn't until 3 days later that I realized where I'd gone wrong. The day that I did it was the 1st of April. Sometimes you just can't pick up.
Now, I've just got one last question. You mentioned quite a bit about your time in the Jamboree area, which is the Illawarra area, and of course you've got a show going on right now at Wollongong. Can you, because Karen Cass is not here today, can you just briefly tell everyone about that exhibition?
At Wollongong?
Yes.
Yeah, after I left Sydney College for the Arts, probably because of a long association with the South Coast, because of Bert Flugelman and my shed and my shack, and the fact, of course, particularly my wife had done a PhD with the University of Wollongong. Incidentally, for what it's worth, and I give this advice to all of you, try to do a PhD in the 70s. God, good luck to her, you know. It's never too late. Bloody good luck to her. She used to get up at 5 o'clock every morning to research. At 75, that's pretty good. Okay, so I had a close association with Wollongong. And I was offered the opportunity of not looking after their collection, but collecting for their collection, buying for their collection, directing their collection, which was great. I mean, I've never had a job like that in my life before, being paid to use somebody else's money to buy. You don't get jobs like that. So that was great. I did that for a while. So the collection that they're showing at their new gallery in Wollongong University now includes works which I have bought on their behalf of other people. It includes works which I have given to them of my own. It includes works which they have bought of my works and my own works. I've always made it clear that as a collector, I certainly didn't collect my own works. But they have wanted to buy some things for themselves, so I've done that, and I've given them a number of things as well. So it's an odd collection of my work I have bought for them. It's worth seeing. It's a nice little gallery they've built in Buco, and it's an interesting show.
Thanks, Guy. Now, I would just say that for those of you not that familiar with Guy's practice, it's really worthwhile to have a good look at what's on here, the exhibition currently on here, but also please visit the show at National Art School and the one at University of Wollongong.
I'd like to say something that is show is the best show I've had for a long time.
Mm.
I think. I think it is likely that there are people who should be seeing it who are lazy, get too lazy to get off their backsides and come over the bridge to see it. And what it has that is the fact that it's been chosen for in decades, so there's something from every decade, from the 1950s, I guess.
40s.
Is there a 40s?
Yeah, the two
watercolors.
Ah, yes, yeah. So it's a very comprehensive show, and it fits astonishingly well with other shows that are on at the moment, particularly with the National Art School show, and with the show at Kiang, which unfortunately is closed now. So it completes a trilogy of shows which, on the whole, give an astonishingly good coverage of what the very good things I've done over the last 50 years. If anybody has any questions, I'm happy to ask, to answer them. Yeah, anybody has any bright, intelligent, sensitive. Yeah.
Guy, when you came back from England, how important was it to get back to the Australian light?
It's a good question because it made a big difference to me. To be perfectly honest, I was utterly depressed. London had been so exciting, really it was. Everybody trying to find their lives again after the war. I came back to Sydney and Sydney looked duller than it had ever looked before, it looked awful. I thought that it looked paintings looked out of date and just dull, except for one person, and it was the only painter I thought was doing what I was trying to do, but I thought doing it better, and that was Ian Fairweather. And Fairweather was painting the landscape, but he was putting figures into it as well, and somehow he was making them part of the paint, not just as figures, but part of the painting. And he was the only one who I really liked. I met the old boy later and liked him and his work very much. It was good to get back to the Australian landscape. Yeah, I enjoyed that. It's good to get back to the rainforest at Jamboree. But that's a weird piece of information. I don't know why I like rainforest. No idea. I think it's maybe because I'm a bit like the figures in the landscape. If you're in rainforest, you are totally encompassed by, totally held by part of the landscape. You're there, it's all around you. You're not standing here looking at it. It is around you, you're in it. You can, it's a bit like a painting. You can, it's a drawing all around you. You've got leaf over leaf over leaf over leaf, tree over tree over tree, and yet through it occasionally you see depth. So it's a bit like a painting where you manipulate perceived depth as well as what's happening on the surface. Does that all make sense or not? And then you get vines, of course, which wind their way. You know, I can see them looks like vines winding their way through the bush. And they're like line drawings in space. They're like three-dimensional line drawings just wandering through space. Look, I don't know what else.
Guy, I'm interested to know, do you find being a painter, I suppose, a bit like being a writer, is a lonely life?
Yes, it is. It is very lonely. I envy musicians. If I had another go at life, I would like to be a jazz musician. I see them sitting on the stage there, three, four, whatever number there are, and they've all got smiles on their faces. And I could see them. Somebody starts a theme and plays with it, and he tosses it to somebody else who picks it up with another instrument and plays with that. And it's so inventive and so about community. It's about working together with three or four or five people. And I think, God, that must be exciting. I'd love to do that. Painting, you're on your own. It's a lonely, lonely occupation. Maybe that's why you want to show them, share it with other people.
Sorry, we'll take one more question.
We've spoken a lot about people, landscape, and so on. I just wonder if you'd like to say something about those paintings over there, which are done in New York, and they seem to be somewhat different.
Yeah, well, that's very simple. The studio at New York had a big room and had a big two windows at the end, which were round at the top. My wife had just brought herself a little summer frock. One of the paintings, which is not here now, is of her figure against the window with this particular little frock on. I think it had yellow stripes on it. And I continued from that and did a number of them, but they were about joy in New York.
I think, Guy, though, that they also relate to that kind of the absolute archetypal fertility goddess form, when you look at the actual figurative shape, and I know that you've had a big interest in antiquities and collecting objects from Oceania and so on and so forth, and you know you can't help but immediately read those pictures with that archetypal fertility goddess, which then became the tree fern goddess in your other paintings. But also, I guess I remember you talking about the energy of New York and the pace of New York and just the intense excitement. So the colour palette in the New York series is very, very bold, very very strong. But again, as Guy's mentioned, that form of the studio window and this big hair, that big sweep of hair that comes off that female figure, again, harking back to those oceanic tribal or cultural attire of the women in both, because this incredible amalgam of influences coming into the images here.
Yeah,
I think they're some of my favorites. I love them all. I can't choose, but I do love those strong women.
After you've lived for a long time, you certain images, certain images in your life become immensely important to you. And after a while, they get a bit mixed up too, and you find you're being, yes, they come together and you start to using them together. Although they might have appeared from different sources in your life, you end up, it's about living, we're all the result of all our experiences. So I suppose what I'm saying is that painting is a bit like a life.
thanks for your time. If you have had a good chance to look at the works in this exhibition, please do. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.